Assalamu alaikum class. Today we are going to discuss a very important topic from examination point of view, which is health indicators. As the name is suggestive, health indicators means that they indicate the health status of a community. We all know that health is generally defined as a physical, mental, and social well-being, and it's a state in which we just say that it's not merely the absence of disease or infirmity in a person. And we have discussed in our last lecture that it is difficult to measure health of a community. So we have devised different other parameters on which we count and measure the health status of that community, which may include the disease status, which may include the death indicators, which may include illness indicators. They can include the indicators related to disability. So in a nutshell, I will say that health indicators means that these are the measurements which are done in a community, which actually reflect the health status of that community. Why these are important and what is their significance? We will be discussing it in this lecture today. So the learning outcomes of this lecture are that we will be discussing that what are different uses of health indicators, what should be the qualities of an ideal health indicator, what are different types of health indicators, and then we will be discussing mortality indicators in this lecture in detail. So going towards the health indicators, as I have already mentioned, that health indicator means that we want to indicate the health status of a community. So they actually measure the health status of a defined geographical area. They not only reflect the health status of a defined geographical area, but they can be used for the comparisons of the health status of different areas. For example, we can say that health of Pakistani nation is better than the health of the population which is residing in Nigeria by measuring different health indicators. We can do comparisons. For example, the Pakistani population is suffering from lung cancer as compared to the population of Japan, in which the incidence of cancer of stomach is far more as compared to Pakistan. So the health indicators not only measure the health status of a community, but they are also used for the comparison of the health status of different communities. While comparing the health status, they also help us to assess the needs of that community. For example, if a population is composed of a structure in which the geriatric population is much more as compared to the adolescent population, definitely the healthcare needs will target the geriatric population. For example, if we compare the population of Pakistan with population of United Kingdom, the geriatric population means that the population which is more than 65 years of age is far more in United Kingdom when we compare it with the Pakistani population, where the majority of the population is composed of the people who belong between 0 to 15 years of age group. This is the change in the population dynamics. So whenever we go into the details of the population dynamics and the health indicators, they also help us to identify that what are different needs of that population. So when we are well versed that what are the needs, the health indicators also identify us to allocate our health resources. For example, in Pakistan, if we have high maternal mortality and high infant mortality rates as compared to the rest of the world, so we have to allocate our resources in such a direction that we can reduce the maternal mortality and infant mortality in Pakistan. In resource scarce countries where the funding is less and the population dynamics does not allow us to spend more on health, the resources are allocated on need base. So the health indicators indicate us towards the direction in which a country with scarce resources has to target the funding and the resources. For example, one of the indicators of Pakistan is that Pakistan has high incidence of cases of tuberculosis. So there is need that Pakistan and the government of Pakistan should give funding to target the patients who are being diagnosed with tuberculosis or who are on the treatment of tuberculosis. And they should put more funds for the DOTS therapy and tuberculosis therapy, etc. So health indicators not only help us to measure the health status of a community, they are used for the international and local comparisons as well. They help us to identify the healthcare needs. They help us to identify the positioning of the resources. And then when we have developed the programs for specific diseases, the health indicators are used to monitor and evaluate the healthcare services. And you have been taught in detail that what is monitoring and what is evaluation. Monitoring means that if country has started a program, let's talk about the tuberculosis control program, and tuberculosis control program has specific targets to attain. So monitoring means monitoring the activities day by day to see that whether this program is achieving its target or not. For example, if the tuberculosis control program targets that we will identify 200 new cases every day in the country, then as a public health evaluator, we will see that whether we are achieving the target of looking after the new 200 cases in the community or not. And evaluation means that at the end of the program, have we achieved our health indicators or not? For example, I can give you an example of evaluation that by the end of 5 years, the incidence of tuberculosis will be reduced by 5% by effective TB control program. This is an example of evaluation which is done at the end of the specific time period. So health indicators are really, really important. And they have specific role in lives of public health personnel and epidemiologists. And throughout 1 year, we will be talking about health indicators in detail. So this concept should be very clear in your mind. And the health indicators which we will be discussing today should be very clear to you from the examination point of view as well. So whenever we talk about the health indicators, we say that an ideal health indicator should have the following characteristics. It should be valid. Valid means that the health indicator should actually measure what it is supposed to measure. For example, if we are using an indicator let's suppose we say that we are going to conduct the mammographies of a population to identify the lesions which are present in the mammary gland, which are not evident externally. So it should actually be able to identify all the lesions which are present, and if it is actually attaining this target, we say that mammography is a valid test to identify the lesions which are not evident externally. Fine. So another example of a health indicator means that the indicator should be reliable. It means whenever we apply this particular indicator or this particular test to a community, it will give same repeatable results again and again. It means, for example, if we are looking into the serum cholesterol levels of a community, the same test produces same results, and they can be comparable. So reliability means that the answer will always be the same if the same test is applied in different populations and in different circumstances. Sensitive indicator means that the ability of a test to identify all the true positives in diseased population means that it is sensitive test. It means, for example, we all know that the gold standard for identification of the breast cancer is histopathology or excision biopsy of the histopathology. On the basis of histopathology, we say that we are 100% sure that this particular tissue has the lesion, which indicates the characteristics of neoplasia. But we can expect the same results by applying another test, for example, on ultrasound of the mammary glands or the breast can sometimes identify the true lesion. Mammography can identify the true lesion. Sometimes fine needle aspiration helps us to identify the true lesion. So sensitivity means the ability of a test to identify the true positives in the diseased population. And the sensitivity of each test will be different. Then specificity means that ability of a test to identify all those who are truly negatives among the non-diseased population. If as public health consultants, we are concerned about identification of the true positives through sensitivity of a test, it is important for us to also identify the true negatives. So we should not spend our resources on the true negatives person because we already have scarce resources. So it is again important for us to identify the true negative population as well. Then it is important for us to identify that which test is a feasible test or which indicator is a feasible indicator and which test should be able to contribute effectively to study or understand the phenomena of interest by giving an explanation of the relevance. So a health indicator should always be a valid indicator. It should be a reliable indicator. It should be a sensitive and specific indicator. It should be feasible to run that indicator in the community, and it should be relevant, which can explain the total phenomena which is concerned to it. If I will give you this example, for example, the target of us is to target the bull's eye, and we are sending arrows which are actually not targeting the bull's eye, but they are in the circuit, and this repeated same results are produced again and again. It means that this test is reliable because it is producing the same results and then again and again, but it is not valid because it is missing the target. So this condition shows reliability, but this particular condition does not show the validity. Look at this, that one of our target is that we attain our aim of three, aiming the three circles, we are attaining our aim, but the results are haphazard and scattered, and they are not producing the same repeatable results. So in this condition, we will say that the test is valid, although it is aiming the whole population, but it is not reliable because it is not producing the same results again and again. In this condition, either it is nor it is valid and nor it is reliable because it is not producing the, for example, if we want to target only the bullseye, here in this condition, it is neither reliable because it is not producing the same results again and again, and it is not targeting the bullseye. And this condition is the ideal condition in which a health indicator or a test which is performed is both reliable and it is valid because it is targeting what it actually wants to target. So it is valid and the same repeatable results are produced. So it is reliable as well. So a health indicator should be valid, it should be reliable, it should be sensitive, it should be specific, it should be feasible to conduct, and it should be relevant to explain the phenomena which is associated with it. So whenever we want to talk about the health status of a community, we deal with different types of indicators. And basically, they show the health measurement or the health status of a community. The health can be measured in terms of mortality indicators, which indicate that what is the total number of death which is occurring in a population. It can be in the measure of occurrence of a disease. It can be an old disease, it can be a new disease, or it may be a total diseased population, which is measured in terms of morbidity indicators. Then the population can show disability and inability to perform certain tasks because of illness or injury, which is measured in the form of disability indicators. As public health consultants, we want to measure the nutritional status of our community as well, because the health of a community is directly related to the nutritional status. So we deal with nutritional status indicators as well. We are involved in measuring that what are the healthcare delivery indicators and what are healthcare utilization indicators. The healthcare delivery indicators mean that what services are being provided by the government to the community. For example, how many doctors are available, how many nurses are available for the population, how many trained birth attendants are available, how many dentists are available, what is the hospital bed ratio, what is the occupancy rate. These all indicate the healthcare delivery indicators. But healthcare utilization indicators basically tell us about that what percentage of the population is actually utilizing the healthcare services. For example, how many pregnant females are actually delivered at the government hospitals? How many newborn babies actually get the services during delivery? How many newborn babies or under 1 year of age babies are getting immunization services? How many pregnant females are getting tetanus toxoid vaccines? So this basically shows that what is the utilization rate by the community, and this shows basically what government is offering to the community in terms of delivery of healthcare. So we as public health consultants are actually concerned with both of these indicators as well. We are concerned about the social and mental health indicators, as we all know that the definition of health is incomplete if we do not encounter the social and mental dimension of health. We are also concerned about the environmental indicators, that what is the air pollution index, what is the soil pollution index, what is the water pollution index, and what is indoor air pollution, etc., etc. We are also concerned about the socioeconomic indicators. As when we were discussing the determinants of health, we knew that socioeconomic condition affects the health status. So there are other indicators which also include the health policy indicators, indicators of quality of life, social indicators, and basic need indicators. So in today's lecture, we will be only discussing mortality indicators in detail, and in our subsequent lectures, we will be discussing the other indicators. But in a nutshell, I will say that these indicators are really, really important from the examination point of view. And you must memorize their formulas, and you must know that what is their significance and how they affect the health status of a community. So moving forward towards the mortality indicators. The mortality indicator means that the indicators which measure death in a community. For example, this is community A and this is community B. People are residing here and people are residing there. And we want to assess that what is the difference in the health status of this community when we compare it with this community. So what we will do, we will see that what is the total number of deaths which are occurring in this community, and then we will compare with the number of deaths in this community. And we will say, we can safely say, this community is community B is a healthy community because the number of deaths are limited in this particular community when we compare it with community A, because the number of deaths are much more in community A. But there is another factor which can affect the health status, which shows that what is actually the denominator when we calculate the death rate, because the total number of population is different in both the communities. You can see that community B is thickly and overpopulated, and community A has less population. So whenever we want to compare the death rates, we will not only talk about the frequency of death which is occurring in one community, and we will compare it with the frequency of death which is occurring in the second community. We will always calculate the rate in which the numerator and the denominator both will be considered, and then there will be a comparison. So the crude death rate will be equal to the number of deaths in a specific community in a specific time period divided by the mid-year population of that community in that particular specific time period is known as crude death rate, and we always calculate crude death rate in per thousands for the comparisons of different communities. So crude death rate means the total number of deaths which are occurring in a specific area in a specific time period divided by the mid-year population into 1000. It will give us the crude death rate of a community. Why do we call it as a crude death rate? Because it gives us the total number of deaths in that community, and we cannot compare that what is the distribution of age and sex according to the crude death rate. So this is one of the calculation you have to do. It says that in calendar year of 2020, the total number of deaths reported in New Mexico were 15,231. An epidemiologist was interested in calculating the death rate of that area and noticed that total population at the beginning of the year was 200,000. And he observed that by the end of the year, this population was this. And on July 1st, population was this. So you have to calculate the crude death rate for that epidemiologist. Please do these calculations. So whenever we talk about the crude death rate, we are actually concerned about the total number of deaths in those communities, and we compare them. But when we go into the greater details, we say that each population has different composition of age and sex. There is two gender distribution. There are males, there are females, and there are different age compositions in a community. For example, there are people who are less than 5 years of age, there are newborn babies in that population, adolescent population, reproductive age population, the old population. So when we compare them in two communities, we cannot say that what is the total number of deaths which are occurring in different genders or in different age groups. So crude death rate gives us a rough estimate of the total number of deaths which are occurring, but it does not specify the number of deaths according to gender distribution or according to age distribution or according to disease distribution. That's why we call it as crude death rate. But when we want to dig out further that what is the death rate occurring in specific age groups or in specific gender groups, we calculate specific rates. So one of the example of the specific rates, specific death rate, is age specific death rate. So how do we calculate age specific death rate? Age specific death rate is equal to the number of deaths of a person of specific age group in a specific community in specific year divided by the total number of population in that particular specific age group per thousand in that community will give us a true reflection of age specific death rate. And by comparison of age specific death rate within community A as compared to community B, we can compare that all those communities in which the infant mortality rate is high, it means there is deficiency of the healthcare service provision. Or if the population has a higher death rate in geriatric population, then we can say that this particular population has a much more geriatric population as compared to the adolescent or younger population. And we have to target our healthcare service provision towards the geriatric population. So age specific death rates are important for the comparison because it tells us and it gives us a comparison in that particular age group. So during COVID pandemic in 2020, the maximum number of deaths were reported in European region in the elderly population. And statistics of a country X showed that this is the age group distribution. These are the total number of deaths which are occurring in that particular age group. These are the total number of deaths due to COVID. And these are the total mid-year population in those age groups. So you have to calculate age specific death rate for population of more than 65 years in according to this data. Please do that. Please do these calculations along with the flow of the lecture because you will be submitting all your assignments at the end of the lecture. Do not move further with the slides of the lecture until and unless you have done your calculation. Okay, going further, the next indicator is life expectancy. And the life expectancy says that the average number of years that will be lived by those born alive in a population if they pass through the current age-specific mortality rates, we measure the life expectancy. For example, we say that in Japan, the life expectancy is more than 83 years. It means we expect that a newborn baby, if passes through all these age-specific mortality rates, he can reach up to the age of 83 years in Japan. But the life expectancy in Pakistani population of a male is only 65 years. So we can also do comparisons according to the life expectancy of individuals when they are born alive and they pass through the successive current age specific mortality rates which are present in the community. So infant mortality rate, one of the example of age specific mortality rate, infant is a newborn baby who is less than 1 year of age, and infant mortality rate is the most sensitive indicator of a health status of a community. Pakistan has high infant mortality rate. Many people die before newborns die before they reach the age of 1 year. So we calculate the infant mortality rate, which says it is the total number of deaths of infants who are below 1 year of age in an year in a specific area, in a specific community, in a specific time period, divided by the total number of live births in an year in that particular community into 1,000. Actually, it should be measured by the total number of babies who are under 1 year of age. But as we do not have the follow-up facilities and we do not have the good record keeping system in Pakistan, so we calculate the infant mortality rate in which the denominator is the total number of live births which are reported and their records are being kept by the government of Pakistan. So infant mortality rate is basically the most sensitive indicator about the health status of a community. It tells us that what are the available resources which are targeted towards the pregnant females and the newborns, what is their utilization rate, what is the effectiveness of the healthcare service provision, and so this indicates the most sensitive indicator. And whenever we want to do comparisons of different countries, the first and the foremost important indicator on which we do comparison is the infant mortality rate of those countries. So there were 80,000 infant deaths in Nepal in 2020, and the total number of live births was 900,000. So find out the infant mortality rate for Nepal last year. So please do this calculation before moving to the next slide. Another indicator which tell us about the services of healthcare provision to the pregnant females during delivery is the early neonatal mortality rate. And the early neonatal mortality rate calculates the total number of deaths of children under 1 week of their soon after their birth, divided by the total number of live births in that particular area, in that specific community, in that specific time period, into 1,000. Again, a very important mortality indicator, which indicates that the inadequate healthcare service provision was to the pregnant lady during the delivery and during the early neonatal period to the newborn. Late neonatal mortality rate, it is the total number of deaths of children occurring between 1 week of their birth up to 4 weeks, divided by the total number of live births in a year in that particular community in that specific time period into 1,000, indicates the late neonatal mortality rate. When we look into the early neonatal mortality and late neonatal mortality, the early neonatal mortality basically occurs because of the inadequate healthcare service provision during delivery. For example, delayed labor, obstructed labor, precipitated labor, poor management of natal services during delivery, meconium aspirations because of the delayed labor, or poor management of the medical conditions can lead to the early neonatal death. If there is birth asphyxia, if there is meconium aspiration, if there is cerebral hemorrhage due to the anoxia during delivery, it can lead to the early neonatal death. But the late neonatal mortality occurs because of the congenital malformations of the babies. It can occur because of the non-neutralization of the immunization rates, which are for the prevention of diseases. It can be due to the inadequate breastfeeding. It can be due to the poor weaning services, or there are multiple other reasons of the late neonatal mortality rate. But these mortality rate actually indicate the health status of a community for the international comparisons. And let me admit that Pakistan has highest neonatal mortalities, early neonatal mortalities and late neonatal mortality rates in the world. Then we have postneonatal mortality rate, which includes deaths after 4 weeks of birth up to 52 weeks, divided by the total number of live births in a year in that specific community into 1,000. So whenever we want to calculate the infant mortality, we can also calculate them by summing up the early neonatal mortality, late neonatal mortality, and postneonatal mortality rates. Because the early neonatal mortality calculates the mortality rate up to first 7 days of life. The late neonatal mortality rate can calculate up to 1 month mortality, and postneonatal mortality rate can include from 1 month up to 52 weeks period. So by summing up the early neonatal mortality, late neonatal mortality, and postneonatal mortality rates, we can again calculate the infant mortality rate. A very important viva question. Then another important rate which is used for the international comparisons is the maternal mortality rate. The maternal mortality rate is the total number of deaths of women due to pregnancy complications, or during delivery, or after childbirth, within 42 days of the delivery. So it includes the antenatal period, it includes the natal period, and it includes the postnatal period. And the deaths which are occurring in at that particular time period divided by the total number of live births in that particular community into 1000 is reflecting the condition of maternal mortality rate. Again, Pakistan has high maternal mortality rate. There are multiple reasons of high maternal mortality rate in Pakistan. There are early marriages, teenage pregnancies, low literacy rate, the gender discrimination, the females do not have access to the family planning practices, large number of pregnancies, multi-gravida, poor abortion services, medical conditions associated with pregnancy, poor natal care management, inadequate healthcare service provision to the pregnant ladies, obstructed labor, delayed labor, pregnancies with different complications, they all can lead to the maternal mortality, high maternal mortality. And even with the poor obstetrical management, if there is postpartum hemorrhage after delivery or there is septicemia, it can again cause death of the mothers. So again, a very sensitive indicator to show that what is the provision of the healthcare services to the community if the mothers are dying. So maternal mortality rate, again, a sensitive indicator to assess the health status of a community. So it's time for critical thinking. You have to identify the five major reasons of maternal deaths in Pakistan. You have to jot down that what do you think that what are the five major reasons of high maternal mortality in Pakistan. Moving further, going towards the perinatal mortality rate. Okay, what do we mean by perinatal mortality rate? Perinatal mortality rate actually reflects the poor healthcare service provision during delivery. So if there is stillbirth and death under 1 week of a live born is divided by the total number of stillbirths plus the total number of live births in a year are calculated and they are multiplied by 1000, it gives us a perinatal mortality rate. It reflects the inadequate healthcare service provision during the natal period to the pregnant ladies. Again, a very important indicator. Another important indicator is child mortality rate, the number of deaths of children aged 1 to 4 years in a specific community, in a specific year, divided by the total number of children between 1 to 4 years in that community, in that specific year, multiplied by 1000 indicates the child mortality rate. So we all know that according to the age distribution, the death rates are actually calculated. So infant mortality rate calculates the death of the children under 1 year of age. And if the death is occurring after 1 year of age, and before the completion of 5 years of age, it is calculated between the number of deaths of children between age 1 to 4 years of age group. And this is represented by child mortality rate. You can understand the significance of child mortality rate as one of the major goal of Millennium Development Goals and the social development and the sustainable development goals is to reduce the childhood mortality. So this is one of the universal health coverage goal, which indicates that how the healthcare service provision is to the children of a country are addressed by comparing the child mortality rates of different countries. So under 5 proportionate mortality rate is actually calculated by the total number of deaths of children less than 5 years of age group in a community in a specific area divided by all the number of deaths which are occurring in that area in that specific time period into 1000. Proportionate mortality means it is one of the part of the whole. So all the total number of deaths in that community are taken as denominator. And what is the percentage of the death of the children under 5 years of age group which are occurring in comparison to all the deaths in that community reflect the under 5 proportionate mortality rate. Pakistan has high under 5 proportionality mortality rate. proportionate mortality rate. And now I will not tell you that what are the five major killers of children under 5 years in Pakistan. It's time for you to critically think and submit your answer that what do you think that why the children under 5 years of age are dying in Pakistan and why we have so much high rate of under five proportionate mortality rate in Pakistan. So moving further, adult mortality rate, the number of deaths of adult population between 15 to 60 years divided by the medieval population into 1000 will give us adult mortality rate. And we have different reasons of adult mortality rate. For example, in Pakistan and in India, the major cause of mortality for adulthood is basically the cardiovascular diseases. And majority of the population is suffering with ischemic heart disease. But when we go towards the Gulf area, we see that one of the major reason of adult mortality in Gulf area is the road traffic accident. And there the people do not die because of the heart diseases. There they die because of the road traffic accident. So we can do comparisons by calculating different adult mortality rates and by going subsequently into the details of those mortality rates. Then we have specific death rates, which are due to the specific diseases or due to specific gender or due to specific disease. So we have disease specific death rate, and one of the example can be calculated the specific death rate due to tuberculosis. This can be calculated by the total number of deaths from tuberculosis during a specific time period in a specific community divided by the median population into 1000 will give us the specific mortality rate due to that particular disease. So we can calculate different mortality rates due to different diseases, and we can identify that which disease is causing much more higher mortality rate, and we should fund and we should allocate our resources for that particular disease. So again, the same table is given to you. And now my question to you is calculate corona specific death rate in this population for the year 2020. Moving forward, proportionate mortality rate due to tuberculosis, as the name proportionate is given. So we can calculate, we know that it is part of the whole. So total number of deaths from tuberculosis during the year divided by the total number of deaths occurring in that community in that particular year will give us the proportionate mortality rate due to tuberculosis. So another term is the case fatality rate, in which again, if I want to measure the case fatality rate due to tuberculosis, the numerator will contain the total number of deaths occurring due to tuberculosis divided by the total number of cases of tuberculosis into 100. So actually it indicates the killing power of a disease. So total number of deaths due to a particular disease divided by total number of cases due to that particular disease will give us the case fatality rate. And case fatality rates are measured in different countries, and they indicate the health status of different countries as well. For example, the case fatality rate of corona was different in European countries, and it was different in the let's suppose Australia, it was different in Pakistan, it was different in India. So the killing power of that particular disease varied according to the genetic material of the population, due to age distribution of the population, due to the sex distribution of the population, etc. So whenever we want to measure the killing power of the disease, we will calculate the case fatality rate. And last is known as the survival rate. Survival rate is actually calculated for the survivors of the long-term disease, and they are particularly calculated for the cancer patients. It is calculated as the total number of patients alive after 5 years of the treatment of a particular disease divided by the total number of patients diagnosed or treated with that particular cancer into 100. And usually the survival rates are calculated for the cancers, and they are used for the comparisons of different cancers, and they are used for the comparisons of survival rates in different age groups as well. So we have covered the mortality indicators in detail. I have given you few examples. I have given you few calculations. These are just the introduction of these rates, and we will be addressing them again when we will be covering our demography, when we will be covering our epidemiology in further detail. But let me re-emphasize again that these rates are actually important rates, and they are very important from the examination point of view, and they will constitute the bulk of your test, which has been announced already. So if you have any question, you can contact me through Facebook group, and I will be available for your answers. Thank you.